time for me to go to college, several facts were very evident to me. One, I was not rich enough to go to the school I wanted. Two, I was not a good enough actor to get a scholarship to that or any other school. I would later excel as a playwright, but I did not know that yet. And three, I was very, very gay. And everybody knew that. So I found myself enrolling at the local community college and beginning my tutelage there. Began boringly enough, acting one.
To be or not
to be.
Voice one.
Buttercup.
Me, zero. I couldn't find my place no matter how hard I tried. The place that I did find was amongst the other outcasts, the other techies. You see, in the theater, there are two types of people, the stars and the techies. The techies build the sets, the stars act upon them. The techies set the lights, the stars bask in them. The techies build the costumes that make even the dullest star shine. The techies ran things from the wings, hidden in the dark, but that was fine. It gave me the opportunity to observe the stars, to see how they worked, how they schmoozed, how they partied. Who was dating who? Who was screwing who? Who was screwing who while dating another who? It was during this period of observation that I noticed Randy. He was definitely a star. Star among stars. All the girls loved him. The guys did too. She's perfect. Gorgeous hair, beaming smile, the arms, the chest, the legs, the butt. There wasn't one thing wrong with her, or so I thought, but being a lowly freshman, I only saw what everyone else saw. Star from a distance. But things would quickly change. In my second semester, I decided to open up to several of the department queens, and they immediately accepted me into the family. I wasn't quite a star, but being gay could be entertaining enough. This acceptance gave me the confidence to get involved in the department. Who should be in the first show that I teched on? None other than Randy. I learned from the queens that simply everyone lusted after him, but no one had got him, neither male nor female. I thought, maybe there's hope. Well, then I realized I hadn't even been introduced to him. So when it came time for rehearsals to start, I made a conscious effort to introduce myself. He was cordial, and that was that. Then rehearsals were underway, and I found myself watching his every move, listening to his every line. I was starstruck. I was a blubbering idiot. I would try to tell him how great of a job he was doing, and then flash that smile, and I'd be lost. He must have thought I was unable to finish any kind of conversation, but one thing was certain. I was in love. Besides my one-sided love affair, something else very special happened to me that semester. I discovered my talent in writing. It was playwriting one. The class is full of pretentious poets and other brandy rejects. I could call them rejects then because I was in. We were given exercises, we wrote scenes. Well, then finally came the big project, the play. Some in the class floundered, others just downtown drowned. I soared. Whatever I couldn't summon up in acting class just seemed to bubble over when I was at the computer. I was floored. I had found my place. And the word spread faster than the flu in winter. And it was winter, and there was a lot of flu, but that's beside the point. It seems I was the first writing prodigy that the school could boast of in more years than they wanted to remember. They wanted to exploit me, and I was ready to be exploited. So I was given the freedom to write a play that would be produced by the school in fall. Anything I wanted, any subject at all, I could be the director, I could cast, I could direct if I wanted to, but I didn't. Well, that'd just been too, you know. So it turns out this bit of information came into being as the play rehearsing was about to go up. Suddenly I was a star, a bona fide star among stars. Stars wanted to know me, stars wanted me to go out partying with them, stars wanted me to cast them in my play. I told them that I hadn't even written it yet, but they still came after me. All but Randy. That hurt. Finally, on the day we closed, Randy came up to me and asked if we could talk.
Oh, sure, I said. What's up? I know everybody's been hitting you up to be in your show. And I didn't want you to think I was just talking to you, so you cast me.
So you didn't talk to me at all, I said, shocked at the force with which the words came out.
I guess I deserve that. Hey, listen, the show's gonna be a big deal. Everybody's talking about it. They're gonna make you a bigger name than any of the rest of us.
What would they do that?
Haven't you figured it out yet? Anyone can act. But good writers, they don't come to this school that often.
I can't act.
I said, let me down, my God.
You don't have to. You're right. An actor can't act without the script.
I've seen them try.
Then he laughed. He laughed and smiled. I who made Randy smile. I wanted to die.
You're a hard worker.
He said with sincere honesty, it took me by surprise.
People notice that kind of thing. People remember people they can depend on.
You can depend on me,
said Jonathan. As the words left my mouth, I realized how dorky I sounded. But that day it still made him smile. Twice I made him smile. I was definitely on a roll.
So what's your play about? Or have you even started working on it yet?
Yeah. I looked into his eyes to see if he was being sincere, but all I could see was the ever-present sparkle. I decided to try that attack.
It's about a young guy who realizes he's gay and how he deals with his family.
Oh.
His confident air seemed to fade. I hit a nerve.
You write about what you know,
I said.
That's what they say.
I guess so.
This line of discussion was definitely doing something to him. What? I decided to try something.
Gonna need a really great actor for the guy,
I said temptingly.
Oh, too bad you'll be booked up.
Oh, God.
You'll probably be in the main stage show. Won't you?
I was playing him like a Stradivarius, and he was responding to my every touch. Oh, the thought of touching him in the show.
It's my last year. It might not be too tight.
Then you might be available.
I asked calmly.
Might be. We'll have to see. Yeah, it really would.
We stood for a moment silently trying to gauge the other. I took a chance and held out my hand. He took it. He pulled me to him. A hug. Randy was hugging me. A hug tremendous for the inner circle, the truly in. By this action, Randy had elevated me to the upper echelon, to his level. Suddenly thoughts sprang into my mind. Were we friends now? Would we hang out? Would we go out partying together? I looked for the answer in his eyes.
Anyway, congratulations. Hey, don't forget his little people when you become famous.
Don't forget him. What a crazy thing to say. But with that, he turned and left. For one brief moment, Randy had come into my life, and now he was gone. And summer was about to be upon us, so I knew I would not see him again until the fall. Suddenly, though, he stopped and turned back to me.
Hey, I'm listed in the book. If you start casting before classes start, give me a ring, okay?
Yeah, sure. I'll call you.
And he disappeared out the door and out of my life. For now. The summer was a blur. A dark blur, but still a blur. I sat at my computer from 10 at night until 6 in the morning, and I slept all day. I felt like I was becoming a vampire, but it was the best way for me to write. Nick at night could be an amazing inspiration. I was not a total hermit, but my notoriety did give me invitations to the best parties. I went to all of them. At one of these parties, I met a cute post-freshman guy who was joining the ranks of the department queens. He and I started up a mild flirtation, but somewhere in the back of my mind, I felt like I was cheating on Randy. Finally, August steamed in, and I was forced back into the daylight again. I had finished the play, rewritten it again, thrown it all away, and started from scratch. Hated it, loved it, but finally, after 3 months of gut-wrenching anguish, I had a play. I didn't know if anyone else was going to like it, but I had a play that was going to be produced. Now I just needed Randy. I began having meetings with my director. He was straight, but cool. We got along great. Except on one point. I kept bringing up Randy's name, but he didn't feel that Randy could handle it. Well, I argued that Randy was probably the only actor we had who could handle the part. He argued that we should cast a gay actor who could draw from his own life, while I argued that that feeling of not fitting in was universal, and that even a straight actor could conjure it up. He argued that no one would believe Randy as a gay man. I argued that it was the type of role that would break him out of the white-red roles he was always cast to play. His arguments went on for several days, until I finally threw down the gauntlet. I would call Randy, I would give him the script, I would coach him on his audition. Then if the director still didn't believe he could do it, I would concede. My director agreed. As I was leaving that meeting, I wondered what I had gotten myself into. I had never directed before in my life. Randy was going to need things for me. Was I ready to spill my guts to him? Even with the lust I felt for him, I knew bearing my soul would be an effort. I could do it on paper, but face to face with another human being was a different matter.
Can I speak to Randy?
This is he.
I told told him about the dilemma before me, and he seemed nonplussed.
If he needs me to wow him, I'll wow him.
You haven't even seen the script yet.
I trust you.
With that, we made agreements to meet the next day and begin working. My hands were sweaty. I felt like a stupid teenager. Randy was sitting across the table from me, and my hands were sweaty. I felt like the first time Carl and I went out, but that was a different time and definitely a different story.
I read the play.
He said, waking me from the daycare I was drifting into.
Really? What'd you think?
It was cool. Great scene with the mom at the end, though. That really happened.
The fight. It happened. But not to me. It happened to just about everyone I know, but not me.
The thing with the guy. That really happened?
Oh, yeah. Silence. I searched wildly for something less somber to discuss, but twice Carl had entered my thoughts, and just the mention of his name would leave me unfunctioning for hours.
Cut pretty deep, huh?
He asked. Was he being genuine?
Yeah. It did.
Is that why you wrote about it?
Pretty much. I got my revenge on the page.
Man, don't want to piss you off.
You said it.
Cool. This is good to know. Great for the character.
The character. He had been pumping me for information about the character. He wasn't interested in me as a person. He was talking to the playwright as an actor.
How long did you go out with the guy?
Yeah, somewhat innocently.
Are you asking me or the playwright?
Both.
Both.
The more I find out about you, the more I find out about what you were after when you wrote the play. Do you have any idea what it's like for an actor? You get handed a play, you really never know what the playwright was trying to say. You just have to guess and hope you get it right. Here, I have the chance to create a character with all the intentions intact. It's an amazing opportunity.
He smiled, and I nearly melted into the booth.
Now, how long did you go out with the guy?
We met the summer before our senior year. We went to rival high schools and never would have met if it hadn't been for Astroworld.
Astroworld?
I was working in the food court, and he was singing one of the shows. I go see him every chance I could get. Then one day, he shows up at my station.
He found you?
He said he noticed the amounts of times I'd seen the show. I told him I was just trying to stay out of the heat. He just laughed at me and walked away.
Sounds cocky.
Just a bit. Anyway, the next time I show up at the theater, the usher recognizes me and takes me around to the backstage area. He recognized me. That really threw me, but not nearly as much as what happened when I got backstage.
What happened?
He had told everyone at the show that he would have me before the end of the season. And there I was, handed up like a feast on a platter.
Sounds really cut.
I should have seen it coming.
I was just so head over heels. Was he good looking?
Not as good looking as you, I thought. Precariously close, that was.
Yeah, he was.
Was he your first?
Suddenly I realized that I was spilling my guts to my fantasy man, and he was eating it up. It was just too something. My head began to spin, and I wanted to run from the room.
Are you hungry?
I asked, trying to shift the conversation.
I'm hungry. Why don't we eat?
Coffee's fine, thanks.
He stared right through me, and I knew what was coming.
He was, wasn't he?
He asked very seriously.
Yeah.
You knew you were gay before that?
Not really. Well, there were hints, but no overt clues.
How long have you guys together?
A lot that summer. Some during the school year. We did talk a lot on the phone.
Of course.
Then the next summer came and everything picked back up again.
Full force?
And then some.
Again, the weight of panic. How did I get myself in this position?
And then the stuff in the play happened.
Yeah.
Did you ever see him after that?
Once.
What did he do?
It wasn't what he did.
What did you do?
We were standing across the bar from each other. He had this gorgeous guy on his arm. I knew better. But I walked toward him determined to speak to him. He saw me coming, and just when I was a few feet away, he looked me straight in the eyes and kissed the guy full on the mouth. The damn verse. All the pain came back. I started crying and ran out of the club.
Men can be such pricks.
I looked at him. Had I heard what I thought I heard, or was he just playing a sympathetic role who knew he should? Either way, I knew I couldn't stand much more of these chest-opening revelations. I wrapped up our meeting and began discussing our next. Hey,
why don't we go to a club?
He blurted out of the blue.
Do what?
I think it's a cool idea.
A club?
Yeah.
You great research.
Research. I was beginning to be able to read him very well. Always the actor.
There won't be many women.
It's So, we'll have fun together, won't we?
I would love to have fun with you. Did I say that out loud? No. That was close.
Yeah, sure.
I said, trying to hide the excitement I was feeling.
Just a couple of guys out in the town. It'll be fun.
The only thing I could think as he walked away was, you betcha. The night before our date, I didn't sleep a wink. While awake, I tried to pick out something to wear. Wrecked my room while trying to pick out something to wear. Decided I had nothing to wear and would have to go out and get something new in the morning. I then realized I was being a total idiot about the whole thing and went to sleep for an hour or so. Randy's call at 11 woke me from a dream I didn't wish to leave, but we won't get into that now. He was just confirming that we were still going out and that he would pick me up since he didn't know where the bars were. As I hung up the phone, I realized I would never get back to sleep. I flopped back onto the couch. Somehow Tom Brokaw got to my apartment, and we were having an in-depth discussion about the state of the nation, or so I thought. As the fog cleared, I realized that I had gone back to sleep and that it was now 5:15 in the evening. In my days, I must have turned on the television sometime during the day, and it was the network news that had entered my dream state. What a shame. Tom Brokaw is kind of cute. I jumped up and fought my way to the kitchen to see if there was any coffee left from the day before. Hallelujah, there was. I chugged the cold brew and lunged into the shower. As I stripped off my clothes, I realized that I hadn't gone out to get anything to wear.
Shit!
The cold water in combination with the cold coffee began to wake me from my self-inflicted stupor. I felt like I had a hangover, but I hadn't had anything to drink or smoke. I blamed no one but myself. I would have to deal with it quickly because Randy would be here in 3 hours. I didn't have much time. The knock at the door came promptly at 8:45. I had said 8:30, but I wasn't going to bitch. I opened the door and almost fainted. He was a vision. The hair, perfection. The teeth, perfection. The outfit, perfection. The burgundy shirt and those jeans. Those blue jeans that hugged every curve of his.
Ready?
Ready?
You bet I was ready. I like that shirt.
I liked his too. I would have loved his tossed on my floor, but there was little chance that was going.
Thanks. It's kind of old.
God, what was I doing? How could I be going out with this angel? How could he possibly see me? How could I be this lucky?
Did you do any work on the play?
Oh, yeah. The play.
Did you much of anything come today?
Me neither. You excited?
Did it show?
Excited.
About tonight? It should be fun.
Yeah, loads of fun. And I love dental work, too.
Let me get my keys and we can go.
I stepped into my bedroom and followed.
Jeez, I thought my place was a wreck.
The cleaning lady has the year off. He smiled. I was beginning to hate that smile. He could tell me to jump off a bridge and then smile and I'd do it. No thought to it whatsoever. I would just fall to my death with the smile in my mind. As I approached the ground, I realized what a fool I'd been, but by that point it'd be too late. But I made him smile. I love that. I grabbed my keys and lunged for the door. Unconscious of what I was doing, I wrapped my arm around his shoulder and guided him to the exit. He looked at my hand and I felt a shock. I pulled my hand away. He looked at me and smiled. Anxious away from my face was that smile. I could have kissed him right then and there, but I didn't. I slapped him on the shoulder.
Come on, let's get out of here.
He bounded out the door into his car, so I locked the door. Well, that had been scary. It was only 8:50. The ride over was amusing. Singing along with the radio, laughing at the bad commercials. Absent was the serious tone of our last meeting. Absent were the questions about my life and past. It was obvious that this night was meant for having fun. Slowly but surely, I warmed into the mood of the evening. But all that changed as we turned off Westheimer and onto Grand. We were actually going to do this. The clubs were in sight. I couldn't believe I was as nervous as I was. Randy saw it, too. He reached over and patted me on the leg.
What's the matter? You afraid of being seen with me?
For real, I'd be the envy of all.
It's been a while since I've been out. I think I'm nervous about clubs.
Is that really his hand on my leg?
You're not a bad-looking guy. Why would you be nervous about going out?
I tend to be shy in big crowds.
Did you say I was good-looking?
Stick with me. He could fix that.
He could fix anything he wanted. parked the car in California, and we began to walk over to the Triangle.
Where would I take him?
Mining company?
Too dark.
Pacific Street, not as dark, but still questionable. Heaven?
Too many teenagers.
JR's? Possibly, but we still had a ways to walk before we'd have to decide. As we passed the patio at Bobby Agus, I felt the eyes and knew they weren't looking at me. Whole evening be like this, would someone else walk up and steal him away? Was I thinking? I'd kill anybody who tried to invade my territory. We approached the corner of Pacific and Grant and stepped out into the light.
Wow! I never knew this was here.
That was a good thing and a bad thing.
Kinda like the clubs on Richmond.
And that was a bad thing.
Never been to any of those clubs.
I told him weakly. You're
not missing much.
Oh, but I must say that you have.
Where to?
Yes, looking out upon the buildings.
Well, there's dancing here.
I indicated heaven.
Or we could just hang out and soak up the atmosphere here.
I indicated JR's.
Check out the atmosphere. We'll dance later.
You betcha.
As I handed him a beer, I looked out among the throng. I really forgot how crazy these places could get on the weekend.
Wild!
He yelled.
And it's early yet.
Oh, that smile.
But an eagle!
I called to him. He looked at me with that tilted, questioning puppy look.
Mingle! Wander!
Still look.
Swing around.
Oh, okay.
So I started out through the crowded aisle, not even thinking whether or not Randy could keep up. Moving pretty slow, I felt a hand grasp mine. It was warm and moist. I turned around.
Don't lose me, okay?
He said, squeezing my hand tighter. We found a place near the pool table and planted ourselves.
You wanna play?
You betcha.
I'm not that good at pool. And I'm not drunk enough yet just to get out there and play badly.
Come on, I wanna play.
You wanted to play? Who was I to say no?
Okay.
Put our quarters on the table, secure in our place, and waited. Prepared to play the horse with sharks.
Because of my looks.
But that's the nature of the business.
I know.
Silence. His arm, my heart, I jumped.
Come on. I think it's time to dance.
Yeah, that sounds good.
I held up my hand and he took it. Together we ran out of the club like a couple kids. I could hear the beat as we walked up to the building. For some reason that panic thing was coming back. I've been here since that time with Carl.
Probably not. That was probably
as we were waiting in line, I looked over and Randy was already dancing.
Take that till we get inside.
We won't run out. There's more where this came from.
He began gyrating at me and I had to smack him to stop. I didn't really want him to, but people were staring.
You're fine. You're just now finding that out.
He began gyrating at me and I tried to get him to stop, but he started laughing. He laughed so hard he collapsed on my back with his arms around my chest.
You loosen up.
Whispered in my ear. I could have died right then and there, but instead I made the cover and went in. Inside, the club was wall-to-wall bodies. We pushed our way to the bar and grabbed another beer. He looked at me and mouthed one word. Dance. With that, he dragged me out to and onto the dance floor. Now, I've never been that great of a dancer, but I'm okay. Thing was, when I was dancing with Randy, I felt like Paula Abdul. He was such a fabulous dancer. It was like an osmosis thing. I was dancing with him, therefore I was the dancer. 4 minutes felt like an eternity. I could have gone on forever. Give me those red shoes. I'm ready to die. Finally, the song changed, and he dragged me where our beers had been hidden. He took a healthy swig and looked me in the eyes.
How come you got such a low self-esteem thing going?
Must be research.
Yeah, I was trying to get the topic off with me.
You getting enough out of the evening?
Every time I get too close, you do this. What is it about you? Carl?
Yes.
That was a long time ago. You need to let go.
Yes.
Hasn't there been anyone at all that you wanted to jump?
Yes.
Oh my God, not again!
Someone?
Someone I know?
Yes.
Someone I know well?
A definite possibility.
Tell me.
Why should I tell you?
Because I want to know.
If I tell you, will you answer one question for me?
One question?
If I tell you the answer to your question, will you answer one? Summon up the courage to tell him. I was going to do this. I was going to tell him that I wanted him. I could do this. I was capable. Until I saw Paul. Standing across the bar from us, he looked at me and smiled that smirk he called a smile. Randy saw my distraction and looked across. Carl nodded.
You know
him? Yep.
It's Carl.
One and only.
Not bad looking.
I glared at him.
But you can do better.
I looked back across and Carl was gone. I breathed a sigh of relief until he appeared at my side.
Daniel, long time no see.
Not long enough.
I was going to say you're looking better than ever.
You are smooth. Don't have a date tonight.
Randy laughed at that one.
He was enjoying our spy match, but he was definitely staying out of it.
Not yet. But it's early.
Couldn't think of anything witty to come back with. I gave him the opening he needed.
You, seeing anyone? Yourself?
Not really.
I know. Just playing the field?
Something like that. Randy saw that I was beginning to crumble. Suddenly his eyes sparkled as an idea.
Oh, you?
He broke in. I wouldn't say that Carl hadn't noticed Randy. His eyes had been darting in his direction all during our tete-a-tete. But when Randy spoke up, Carl looked upon my friend with all the lust he could muster.
A friend of yours?
He threw in my direction as he gazed upon Randy.
More than friend.
Now, what happened next was told by onlookers. I don't really remember it happening. Randy took my face in his hands, pulled my face to his, and kissed me full on the mouth. It was rumored that there was tongue involved, like I said, I don't remember how. That kiss then went on for 35 seconds, drawing the attention of most of the patrons in our area, these being the persons who told me about the event later. I would love to visit the hypnotherapist and relive the moment. Carl made no sound. He made no attempt to carry on our verbal battle. He picked up his drink and walked away. First thing I remember was Randy's face moving away from my own.
I think I got to him.
Bartender looked over at Randy. It was obvious he'd seen our little display.
You got a hot one there.
He said the real thing about me. My boyfriend is kinda cute, isn't he?
He ruffled my hair and I felt like a kid. Protected like a kid. Loved like a kid. I looked at him and saw that smile I broke. No. Was this all still part of our new friend Carl? Was I part of his research? Was I learning tool? Were we friends? What was I? What were we? I think it was at this point, I think I fainted. The dream as I remember it. The theater was dark, a single ghost light weakly beaming out from the center of the stage. I am drawn to it and begin to move up the steps to the wooden floor. As I approach the light, it goes out. I'm immersed in utter darkness, but I am not afraid. I can sense that someone is here with me, but they are not speaking. I reach out, reminded of a child's game, and hear footsteps moving away. I want to follow, but the fear of falling from the stage keeps me still. I feel a hand press mine, and fear disappears. I feel my right hand being pulled up, as another hand circles around my waist. Dance? I feel my body being pulled in close to another. It is warm and comfortable and perfect. I rest my head on a shoulder and give myself up to the moment. Suddenly the lights come up and I am alone. I am dancing alone. There is no one here with me at all. I search the stage and find no one. I search the auditorium and find no one. I look up at the booth and find no one. Alone, I sit down on the stage. As I am sitting, I feel a hand on mine. I look down and see the hand, I see the arm, I see the body, I see Randy. He's smiling. He looks me in the eyes. He opens his mouth.
I'm not the one.
I hear, but I don't want to. I wake myself so I won't hear the rest. Left before Randy would be auditioning for the director. We were both very agitated, but we didn't seem to be connecting. Something just wasn't right. Eventually, we got to the moment of the play, seeing the director wanted to see. In it, Randy's character is dumped by his boyfriend while the two are dancing. I fed him the lines from my chair, but he just wasn't connecting.
What is wrong?
I asked him.
This isn't that hard.
For you. You just have to sit there on the one up there having...
He trailed off to where I could not tell. He turned away and wandered the room. Finally, he turned back and looked me in the eyes.
Dance with me.
I heard, but did not understand.
I need the body right here in front of me. I can't connect you to the words when you're sitting over there.
I understood, but not fully.
Please, do this for me.
But what if I don't remember the right words?
You wrote it. You'll remember enough. It's not all improv.
Improv.
Just get over here.
I got up and joined in. I had a script in my hand, but there was no way I was going to be able to use it, being this up close and personal to Randy. He looked me in the eyes again.
Take it from the top of 50.
I looked at my script to find my place. Once I had, I tossed the script aside. He stepped up to me and took my hand in his and wrapped his other hand around my waist. He began moving us to some music only he was able to hear. I went with it and rested my head on his shoulder.
I've never been so happy.
Neither could I. Oh, the script.
Never?
I asked, trying to remember my own words.
Never. And it's all because of you.
Had I really written those words? Maybe the scene needed a rewrite.
Sammy, we gotta talk.
I said, stopping the dance, not looking at him.
What? What is it?
I'm leaving. Okay, we can talk later.
No! I'm leaving. I have a job in California and I'm leaving the world.
He broke away from me and began looking around the room for something.
Hey, that's pretty quick. I don't know if I get my things together that soon. I mean, the morning. Somebody might think you were planning on leaving me here.
I was. He turned back to me, and I saw a pain in his eyes that I had not seen before. Is that how I looked when this happened to me? I wanted to take him in my arms and tell him he could survive this, and that he would actually be stronger because of it.
You shouldn't take off and leave me here alone. Why did your father do this? Would it have been more effective if I found out in the letter?
I was going to do that, but I couldn't. Being in your arms like that, I couldn't just split and not let you know what you meant to me.
Meant? It's already over in your head. Why bother doing this?
Because I love you.
Loved. You loved me, and now you're leaving me.
This is what I did. What happened?
Then you shouldn't have said anything at all.
How could I be doing this to him, to Randy? But it was just words, my words, but just words. I took my cue and started at the door.
I better go.
Yes, you better.
Sammy! I'm not the one. God, these were my own words.
What?
You spat at me. I'm not the one. I'm not the one you're going to love forever. I was just the one who helped you see that you could love and that it wasn't wrong. Carl actually said those words to me. I didn't make up that dreck.
You pardon me right there. You helped me to love all right, but you also taught me about hate.
Sammy.
Look, I know you might about not be the one I love forever, but this hate will definitely last.
I wish I'd said those words to Carl, but he'd already beat it out the door by that point. I'm sorry.
Bastard!
I hadn't written that. He collapsed to the floor in tears. Talk about emoting. He wasn't stopping. He continued to cry. I moved in but kept my distance. Randy? Are you okay?
No, I'm not okay.
He pulled his knees up and hit his face. Is it the audition?
No, it's not the audition. It's just me.
I couldn't help myself. I sat down next to him and put my arm around him. What's going on?
The script, it just got to me, that's all.
Script? How?
My boyfriend's leaving for California next week.
Boyfriend? Did he say boyfriend?
Yes, I said boyfriend.
What do you mean by mine?
I wanted to tell you about him earlier.
Boyfriend?
You really never guessed?
Never.
He wanted me to do this play so we could come out. We've been together for 3 years, but nobody knows about this.
3 years? Suddenly I realized that in all the time we had been working, he never told me one single personal thing about him. Now he was spilling his guts.
I was a freshman and he was a senior.
3 years and nobody knew?
Things are changing. But they haven't always been as cool as they are now. That's why we were going to come out.
What, California?
He got a bit on the sofa. He auditioned but didn't tell me. It could be reoccurring or put in next week, but he didn't want me to drop out just to tag along. That's why the script got to me. I just wish he had told me. I hated being a surprise.
Are you guys going to bust up over this?
No. I'm just being stupid. But there is this tiny voice in the back of my head worrying about I'm not coming back. You know, meeting some other young punk on the coast or something.
Then he'd be the stupid one. I said, wiping a tear from his eye.
You're so sweet.
He said, taking my hand in his.
And you'll find someone one day.
What?
I'm not blind. If I might steal from the pro, I'm not the one.
I tried to hide my eyes, but he would not let go of my face.
I wish I were, but I'm not. You'll find him. He'll make me so jealous. You two will be happy. Maybe he'll be your next star after you quit writing for me.
Hey, first I write for me.
I know. But this play feels like it was destined for me.
In many ways it was. He smiled at me and kissed me on the forehead. Suddenly I remember the club. Thanks for helping with Carl.
Glad I was there. No telling what kind of stupid thing you might have done.
You're telling me. We were laughing when the door opened. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't know you were in here. It was my little post-freshman, now sophomore flirtation. There seemed to be a touch of hurt in his eyes. I'm sorry. He was gone. I looked at Randy, who was staring at me.
What?
I asked, not knowing what his look meant.
Recognize that look?
No. Should I?
If you'd ever seen yourself looking at me, you might.
You don't mean.
It's love by yourself.
He is pretty sweet.
And so are you. Go get him. You deserve him.
You're right. I do.
And with that, I was up and out the door. Not without one last look back, though. And smiling that smile that I loved. The smile that I now knew was meant for a friend. The smile that motioned me out the door. I jogged down the corridor and checked around every turn. It was nowhere to be found. I retraced my steps and ended up out the back door. Still, he was not there. As I turned around to go back in, though, I saw him. I had not seen him because of a discarded flat, but he'd been there, watching me. I tried to keep my cool as I moved up to the building. It wasn't working.
Looking for somebody?
He asked through a puff of cigarette smoke. I held up my hand, took the cigarette, and took a big drag.
I was looking.
I felt like that. I handed him back the cigarette.
That pretty boy inside there?
Wasn't quite what I wanted.
He's straight?
He asked through another puff.
That wasn't it.
What was it?
Pedestals versus reality.
What you expected?
Oh no, he was. More.
Really?
It just wasn't meant to be.
Sad?
Sad, looking at me with those deep brown eyes.
Not really. Kind of leaves me open for other things.
Other things?
With that, I placed my lips on his. He was so taken aback that he dropped his cigarette he'd been smoking. I heard the doors opening, but I didn't stop the kiss. I looked over and saw Randy's smile. I think at this point my post-freshman, now sophomore flirtation, fainted.